Welcome to Riley on Film. I'm your host, Damian Riley. You can find out more and subscribe for free always at RileyOnFilm.com. Now, on with the show. Today's feature is the review of Mermaid Down. Well, it's described as this on Internet Movie Database. A mermaid is ripped from the Pacific, her tail is chopped off, and she's thrown into a mental home where no one believes she is a mermaid. Well, fasten your seatbelts, get ready for my review of Mermaid Down. This film came out in 2019. It's been released on some video on demand, Redbox, Prime Video, which is the one that I saw it on, so it is available there if you want to check it out. Free if you're a Prime subscriber. I'm discovering you may not get your mail on time with the promise of Prime, but you will get a lot of cool movies. The mermaid is a lovely young woman. She does an excellent job. She gets caught in a net, and that's a very difficult part of the movie for me because I sort of felt trapped and claustrophobic, but it's very well filmed, and he filmed this whole film on $185,000, which is incredible because a similar attempt at a movie could be Pirates of the Caribbean, and that was, I believe, $300 million. So you do the math how much less this is. Good job. She gets caught in a net. And that's a very difficult part of the movie for me because I sort of felt trapped and claustrophobic, but it's very well filmed. And he filmed this whole film on $185,000, which is incredible because a similar attempt at a movie could be Pirates of the Caribbean, and that was, I believe, $300 million. So you do the math how much less this is. Good job. She gets caught in a net. And that's a very difficult part of the movie for me because I sort of felt trapped and claustrophobic, but it's very well filmed. And he filmed this whole film on $185,000, which is incredible because a similar attempt at a movie could be Pirates of the Caribbean, and that was, I believe, $300 million. So you do the math how much less this is. Good job. The mermaid's name is Alexandra Bokova, and like I said, she's incredible. She's incredibly hot, but it's not focused on her nudity, which is nice. There is some nudity, but it's mostly in flashbacks and in other scenes where she's passed out, things like that. It's not meant to be titillating, for lack of a better word. I heard something funny the other day. I said, are you aware that titillating starts with the word tit? Totally funny, totally hilarious. Sorry, I can't remember where I heard it, but very funny joke. Anyway, we do see some tit of Alexandra Bokova, and she really, I haven't seen her before, I don't believe, but she is amazing in this film. Says that she's known for By Light of Desert Night, The Master of Pulpits, great title, and Mysteries of the Unexplained. Interestingly enough, too, three of those films came out last year, 2019, which I kind of consider this year because, so much has happened in 2020. Trouble with releasing films, trouble with getting to the Redbox and things like that. So the fact that it came out in 2019, I would almost say it came out this year. So the fact that she did three films in 1 year is pretty darn amazing. Actually, yeah, three. Three that we see she's known for.
Please listen carefully.
She's Russian, and she was once in exile for Russia's progressives such as Pushkin, Lermontov, Tolstoy, and she's the first in the North Caucasus region to establish a theater, Stavropol Academic Theater of Drama. Wow, I really like her now. Being born into an artistic family allowed Alexandra to participate and be raised in that environment, and it's paying off for all of us now. Good job. I hope to see more of her. Not naked, necessarily. You know, mermaids have figured prominently into our films in America, and apparently Russia as well. But we have a lot of mermaid films, so just for fun, I looked up some top mermaid films, and here's what we have. The Little Mermaid, which is going to be coming out. I don't know who's going to play her, but it's supposed to be coming out. Empires of the Deep, Mermaid Me, Almond Joy and the Avalons, Polly Mermaid, Mermaids of Mustang Island, Hydrophobia, Siren, which I highly recommend. I'm actually going to watch it again because I did it in a group of films at one time, which I've been watching episode. I'd rather do that one all by itself because there's so much there and it's really well done. I especially love the ending of that one. Onward, Aquaman, Mermaids Against Plastic. I haven't seen that one. The Lighthouse, extremely odd film. I'm not sure if I'd call it a horror, but certainly would call it odd and disturbing, to say the least. Have you seen that one? So it goes on and on. There's one called Tidelands, Jezebel, Mermaid, the Lake of the Dead. So sometimes these mermaids aren't always that nice. This film is doing well, and I'm not surprised about that. It has so many aspects of it that I truly enjoyed, and it was done for so cheap. That should be a lesson to us all, especially movie makers. On Internet Movie Database, there's a picture of where it was sold out up on the marquee of the movie theater. So awesome. That's so awesome. It deserves to have sold out. The way that Jeffrey Grellman, the first-time director, the way he got this gig was that he had written a screenplay and entered it into a contest, and of course submitted it as well. Well, not only did it win the award, but so many people were praising this before it was even given a movie deal. So that's a sign right there that there's power in good writing. Sometimes that will even forgive really bad filmmaking. Like there's a scene where the old man on the ship is trying to chop her tail off, and in doing so, he's like barely swinging. And I think to chop a full woman's midsection, a little bit below that, I guess, is where the tail is cut off, you'd have to really hit that thing, and he doesn't. But we forgive it. Why? Because it's a great story. Stories are important. Remember that, writers. I think mermaid movies and shows are going to vacillate between serious and horror and what else? Kind of this full-orbed thing. Funny, romantic comedies. I would think that they definitely have their place in romantic comedies. I think of Tom Hanks and Daryl Hannah in a film called Splash in the 80s, and that was definitely a romantic comedy, definitely worth watching too. And she kind of makes a little sound, kind of like a dolphin. She makes like a little dolphin sound, and guess what? They do the same kind of sound in this one, but it's not really that annoying, and it stops after they end up getting her where she needs to go, which is a mental hospital. This poor mermaid. They capture her. They chop off her tail, according to legend. I guess that will kill it. And then someone aboard the boat takes her back to a mental hospital, and he ends up being the doctor of the mental hospital. Great story. And so, you think in a mental hospital when you think you're something, I think I'm this, I think I'm that. Everybody says, you're not that, you're delusional. Of course, she doesn't talk, we find out, but they do think she's delusional and they don't understand her at all. So I think that was incredible writing to take it from the sea, from the old dog, sea dogs, salty sea dogs, who do a horrible thing to her, and then put her in this mental hospital. Very interesting writing. But alas, the mental hospital, any time that they're in there, is extremely dark. And my wife made the point, and I totally agree with her, they made it a little too dark. Now, I always like to play devil's advocate, like with such a great director, such a great film, why would they make it so dark all the time where you can't see anything in the mental hospital? And another thing, it doesn't look like a mental hospital. I would have liked to have seen a little bit more, like One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest, just for certain sections of the movie, not the whole movie. Instead, it kind of looks like a sleepover. But it's likely, play devil's advocate, it's likely that they had to make it darker so it wouldn't look totally fake because they didn't have much money to work with. Pirates of the Caribbean can bring up the light as much as they want because they've got millions and millions of dollars to put into anything they need, including CGI.
Please listen carefully.
I think this film is worth watching, even though it made on a small budget, makes the most of it. And really makes every note count on that guitar. And it, boy, this movie plays well. Where did they go? They were in here for a period of time. What could I do with the clothes? I got washed, maybe? I don't know. Where I wouldn't have thrown them anywhere. Check my room in the... that laundry basket I have. And then, I didn't have many of them though, Bella. I only had a few. I want to take a look at one of these scenes and kind of give you my response. Very ominous music. And you know, while I'm thinking about it, this is really loud, turn it down a little. While I'm thinking about it, the music is incredible in this as well. Whoever he got to do his music is a pro. This is orchestral type music. This is not just done on a keyboard in somebody's room. And so I was very impressed with the music. And to find out what a low budget he had, I mean, he must not have paid him that much, which is a shame, because it's like, I mean, equivalent to Indiana Jones and the Raiders of Ark, Star Wars. I mean, see what you think if you haven't seen it. But I think the music is comparable to these big billion-dollar movies. Million-dollar movies. This is one of those scenes where they are in the home. But again, it looks more like a recovery home, like maybe drug rehab. But they do have a doctor there, and a nurse, and a doctor practitioner, who is an intern of the doctor. So they don't really like some of the girls, and they really don't like the mermaid girl when she comes in. She's dying because she needs water. And that's the main conflict. How is she going to get out of this place where no one believes in her? But some of it is touching. And, of course, the ghost. Don't forget the ghost. So I'm trying really hard to not talk about the ending and some of the things, because I know this film has not been heavily watched. It only has 4,000 reviews on Internet Movie Database. So here comes the evil doctor. Now he's going to come in and he just becomes more and more evil. And, I guess just to kind of reiterate, this is not like, yeah, let's check out the gratuitous nudity, dude, pass the Coors Light, you know, no, it's not like that kind of movie. It's actually a really good horror movie, and a pretty good revenge movie as well, especially the very end. So that probably wraps it up for all I have to say, but I just really highly recommend Mermaid Down. I'm giving it a 9 out of 10. The reason it gets a 9 is because it was so dark in the asylum scenes. I wish it was a little lighter in there so we could see what the hell is going on. But other than that, worked for me. I recommend it for you. Go see it. That probably wraps it up for all I have to say, but I just really highly recommend Mermaid Down. I'm giving it a 9 out of 10. The reason it gets a 9 is because it was so dark in the asylum scenes. I wish it was a little lighter in there so we could see what the hell is going on. But other than that, worked for me. I recommend it for you. Go see it.
Thank you for listening to Riley on Film. I'm your host, Damian Riley. You can find out more and subscribe always for free at RileyOnFilm.com. Now, have a great day.